We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
My hometown. I love the song. Welcome, everybody, to the Born to Talk radio show, where conversations plus connections equal community. That's the basis of my show. I'm Marsha Wietecha. I'm broadcasting in my hometown here in Westchester in the LA Talk Live studio. And my guests today actually have a business in my hometown. And I'm going to talk with them in just 1 second, but I got to give a shout out to the Cavs. What a fabulous basketball series. If you're a basketball fan, maybe you wanted Steph to win, but you got to hand it to LeBron. All those tears, he was a really happy guy. And one more thing about basketball. My Sparks are undefeated, and they're playing tomorrow against Minnesota, who is also undefeated. So tomorrow, one of us is going to be moving ahead in those standings. But that being said, sports being over, let's talk about you guys. So today, my guests are the owners of the Melody Bar and Grill, and I'd like to welcome Christian Warren and Bobby Hughes. Welcome to the show, you guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Marsha.
Good to be here.
Thank you. It's lovely to be here, and it's important for people to realize that while we are sitting in what was the old Paradise building, your business is just next door, and we'll be talking a lot about the Melody Bar and Grill. But before we do, I thought we could get to know each other a little bit better, and I'll start with you, Christian. Where did you grow up and go to school?
I'm from Northern California. I grew up in a small town called Fairfax, which is just north of the Golden Gate Bridge.
All right.
And my childhood, in a nutshell, let's see, I traveled the United States 5 times by the age of 3 in a school bus, living in teepees with dogs. No, we weren't Deadhead fans, but yes, my parents were hippies.
Really?
Yes.
All over?
Yes.
Do you have siblings?
Yes, I do. I have 2 younger brothers and a younger sister.
Were they all part of the caravan?
No. After, you know, my dad, he liked his partying ways, and my mom, well, she was a mom and wanted to do what was best for her children, so they went their separate ways. But nonetheless, it was still Fairfax was the last stop before our valley, which was called the San Geronimo Valley, which was the sticks. And that's where it took a while to get out there, and all the kids you met out there, they were kind of, I guess you could equate them to being from the South, but it was our like version, just to give you an idea.
Did you go to school there?
I went to school in Marin. I went to Sir Francis Drake High School. Then after that, I took some classes at a few JCs, the Marin JC and then the Santa Rosa JC. And I decided to move down to Los Angeles and pursue an acting career because I enjoyed theater, but then realized, wow, LA was not what I expected it to be in terms of that whole auditions and producers this and directors that, and it was just such a scene. My first love was cooking, and so then I fell back into the restaurants, but I got into bartending at first.
Interesting. And yeah. Bobby, I'm interested in hearing the same your background story.
Well, that was interesting for me too. We don't really talk about this kind of
oh,
stuff.
Oh yeah, well let me introduce you to your partner.
Yeah, really.
Exactly.
Really. Well, I grew up in upstate New York. In one similar way, I was in the sticks. In fact, the town that I grew up in the most, we moved around a lot also, not in a bus, but it was Stittville, New York, a great little town. But we were out in the boondocks, a small town, and my parents were divorced at an early age for me, not for them. So we have similarities there. But I went to high school pretty much in the same school for the whole time after we quit moving. I think when I was 13, I lived in 12 different places, but things settled down and I had a pretty normal childhood out in the country a little bit. And then I went to Colgate University and I managed to graduate finally.
Good for you.
On St. Patrick's Day, a little bit after nice. After my proper date. And I ended up in New York City. I went to Florida for about 2 years and worked around there. ended up in New York and discovered bartending was really a lot easier than carrying cans for the film industry or moving furniture, a lot of the other things I did, or construction and that kind of stuff. When I discovered bartending, then it was just so much easier way to get by. And it was a lot of fun when you're like 25 and in New York City. It was the way you should see that city, I guess, or it's one way for a poor boy from the sticks to enjoy the place.
Well, how did you? Okay, it's very interesting. Your backgrounds are kind of similar. How did you meet?
All right, I'm sure we have two different versions. We'll meet in the middle somewhere. So, being a bartender, a good friend of mine who was my mentor, a bartender at another local bar in Venice, when I was just getting behind the bar and just had some service shifts, and then I watched him bartend. I'm like, wow, that guy's a master. And he's a mutual friend of ours, actually, mm-hmm. Another guy named Bobby. And it turns out that at one point, our friend Bobby was Bob's barback at the Cheesecake Factory. And so he's kind of like my godfather of bartending, if you
will. There is a connection there through other people and experience. And we probably heard of each other and knew where we worked maybe before we ever actually hung out.
We never crossed paths back then.
Because you'd always work the same nights, you know.
Right.
You know, I mean, you know, you wouldn't. It was pretty hard to go see. If you were a really good bartender, you'd work Thursday, Friday, Saturday nights, and one side or the other mm-hmm. that a day or two. I'm sure I heard of Christian before I ever met him. You know, in people saying, "Oh, I was at Hal's or someplace." You know, Bobby was at Hal's.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's where our buddy Bob. Well, we call him Hap just because there's two Bobs here. Uh-huh. Our friend Hap worked, and then Hap and I back in 2004 opened up a restaurant called Mackay, which is still there. We don't own it anymore, but we gutted the whole place, and Bob came over, and he was going to work for us. He was working down the street at Jay's. He worked there for what, 20 years?
20 years. I ended up working there one night a week for the longest time.
They didn't want to let you go.
Worked there, and then I got fired, and I got hired back for Saturday nights, short memories and all that.
That's funny.
But when I worked at I came by Mackay's, they were building it, basically, and they were pounding nails and, you know, decorating or trying to fix things and whatever. So I just pitched in, and the whole conversation, money was there, and Bobby and you and me and a bunch of other people, but we were talking about the next place. The next place is going to be a dive bar. And, you know, I always hung on to that. I said, that's what we should be doing. It's just like a Hunano's or someplace, you know, where it's just beer, some food, uh-huh. you know, and hopefully a full bar, but maybe not. And just have a kind of a beach place. And really the Melody became that in a way.
And you opened it 8 years ago. Is that right?
8 years.
We took it over 8 years ago.
Well, we're going to talk all about that. We're going to take our first break because I want it now and I want it all by Queen. And I want that from you guys. So stay tuned, everybody. We'll be back in just a couple minutes. You're listening to Born to Talk. I'm Marsha Wietecha with Christian and Bobby. Stay tuned, everybody. Listen, all you people. Come gather around. I got to give me a game plan. Got to say.
Hi, this is Dr. J, inviting you to join us every Tuesdays at 11 a.m. for the Happy Health Radio Show. Join us as we discuss issues affecting your health and well-being, where we listen, analyze, and talk with a heart. So don't forget to tune into Happy Health Radio Show every Tuesdays at 11 a.m. exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Radio Flag, TuneIn Radio, Live 365, AHA Radio, TiVo Radio, and App TV Radio, or just watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk. Everybody knows your name.
like I want to do karaoke. It's like where everybody knows your name. I think there's some frustration of that behind me, but I'm sure you all recognize the song Cheers, the theme. And it's so much what is a resemblance to the business that you have. But I thought before we talk about where you are today, let's talk a little bit about the history. Because in the old days, it was not called the Melody Bar and Grill. It was actually just called the Melody Bar. Do you have some background you'd like to share with us, Bobby, about the background of this business?
Well, yeah. Actually, Melody is the only common thing in the various names that people have called it. And I'm not sure if it was ever legally changed or mm-hmm. even if that's important or whatever. But it was Melody's, Jim's Melody Inn and the Melody. And most people now refer it to old timers or regulars.
Right.
Say Mel's. We're at Mel's.
And Mel's or Bar Mel.
Bar Mel. It's been abbreviated and messed with a lot. But everybody wanted to have a Cheers bar.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Why not? That's like the epitome to have some regulars and new people in all the time, have a great staff. But it's really hard to get. You know, mm-hmm. it's hard to find people that can get along and that understand, you know, what their job really is and to always try to be nice to people.
Sure.
It's really hard. The public is not it's not all that easy.
I bet. When was it established, though?
In 1952.
Shortly after I was established.
It became a bar. I think the building was built in 48. We have a picture of it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't very old then anyway in that picture. And the Paradise didn't exist where we are now.
Uh-huh.
Anyway, the first time it was a restaurant bar, it was actually a steak and lobster place, a very kind of high end. And Jim Marin owned it, and Bernadette was his wife.
All right.
And we actually met Bernadette. Jim was gone a long time ago, but we met Bernadette, and I remember interviewing with her in order to buy it.
Yeah.
It was like we took her to breakfast, and she had to like us, or they wouldn't sell it to us. It wasn't like you can have it. I don't care who owns it.
So was Bernadette and Jim, were they the original owners?
They were the original owners of the bar, and it's still owned. The building is owned by the Marin Trust, which
okay.
is their Michael is one of their sons, and there's another son, but they don't really involve themselves too much. It's run by a lady that controls the trust.
All right.
And that's who we deal with when we. You know, I mean, we hardly ever see or hear from them. We have a very good relationship because
nice.
we don't have to interact too much. There are rumors that we believe that Elvis and his mother actually sat in one of the booths. The sports teams used to come because the Forum is right down the street, right down Arbor Vitae, or you know, Westchester Parkway as it is now. It's only a couple miles straight due east, and the Lakers used to come, mm-hmm. and the hockey teams, the Kings were big. They loved the place. They still do. The latest incarnation of the Kings when they were winning Stanley Cups.
Yeah.
The coach, what's the coach's name? I don't remember.
I forget the coach's name. But, yeah, no, the brass would come in because they love our burgers, so they would come in for lunch because no one would hassle them. They didn't mm-hmm. You go to other areas of LA, like, oh, wow, it's the Kings, and they want autographs.
Right.
They come in. They have their lunch with some players. We still have NHL refs that come through, and they have some crazy stories. And basically, if our walls could talk, most of those players back then would have lost their wives. That's pretty much what these refs had to say about how wild our place was with the Kings and their groupies.
Interesting.
Yeah.
When it first opened with Jim and Bernadette, was it strictly a bar? Did they have food when they first started opening? Do you know?
I believe they had a full bar because our liquor license is grandfathered. It's one mm-hmm. of the oldest
right.
you'll find mm-hmm. in town.
And are they the ones that made it the steakhouse? And they're the
definitely
ones
yes
there?
Yes.
And how long did they own it before somebody else? Because you didn't buy it directly from them. So was there somebody in between?
There's a couple guys in between. They owned it until about the mid 80s,
mm-hmm.
and then there was another owner named Jim. Surprisingly enough, right?
Who's a good friend and comes in and has helped us a lot, actually. And then there was Isaac for a couple of years, and then us. Don't know exactly the transition from Marin to Jim Scriba, but he bought it probably 15 years ago, or at least, or
I would say a little bit longer.
No, I think he had it for 15
years. Oh, yeah. He had it for about 15 years.
Yeah, and then sold it to Isaac, who was a regular there, and he had it for a couple years and then sold it to us and had it a couple years longer because we tried to raise money. It took us, I swear, 3 years to hear my wife, like, if I ever hear Melody, don't talk about that until you have it. Just because, I mean, it was such a long, tedious process of trying to raise this capital.
When you do that, it's like a divorce factory. I mean, we were both able to survive that in that way, but it's very, very hard on everybody.
In the day when you know, this is, you're in my community, so I did grow up here and I did go to the theater. That this is where our broadcast studio is. This was the Paradise Theater. And then I worked at Bank of America. It was like my first job out of high school. And back in those days, now we're talking about 1967, 68, if the banking hours were very different. And on Good Friday, the banks would actually close from 12 to 3 so that people could go to church. And our church was at the bar, Melody, and that's where we went. There was no, honestly, it wasn't like there weren't a lot of walking available choices. If you think about the whole corridor along Sepulveda, which leads us to the airport, you guys really were, and obviously so close to B of A, you were really the place to go. And I think that what's so cool about your restaurant is it has this nostalgic feel about it. You know, the whole vibe inside there feels very like an old-fashioned steakhouse or bar or something like that.
Yeah, we wanted to keep that. Really quick, I just wanted to backtrack to,
sure, please.
To my wife. It wasn't all like that. She supported me through this whole process. I love you. And just wanted to make sure everyone knew that.
Oh, she's listening.
He loves you.
And it's, you know, she is the reason that we own it, actually, you know, just to helped out along the way and helped supporting me to get there. So, yeah, it's the nostalgic feel when you – that's one of our favorite things about the place is just the history behind mm-hmm. it. And there's so many restaurants or bars that get bought up and then themed out, and it loses that energy. It loses that feel. And when you walk through, so many people from the East Coast or other parts of the country – it has a familiar feel to them, like their old, their hometown bar.
And that is exactly how it feels, whether you're in the actual bar or you're into your little dining area or you go over to the pool table area. I mean, you have a lot of different pockets of places for people to congregate.
Well, fortunately, we didn't have any extra money to overboard. We did a lot, actually. We really did a lot, and yet we didn't have the means to really transform it, and I'm really happy about that. We didn't really want to. We did some essential things and then a few artsy things, and basically we're a couple of bartenders that somehow managed to buy a bar, and it doesn't happen very often.
Yeah, well, originally when we took it over and we came in, we looked at the space like, oh, this is a cool dive bar. But we didn't know how divey it got. It got to like a super seedy dive bar.
I remember.
And the windows were all blocked out. It was one of the last bars you could smoke in. We had vampires during the day. You could buy anything you wanted from the bartenders besides the booze.
Except food.
Yeah, except food, right? And then at night, let's just say it was a territorial thing between local gangs, and there were a lot of shootings and stabbings in the parking lot. And we didn't know that history. Before we bought it, right?
I didn't know that history. I live here. Wow.
No, it was actually.
Well, I wouldn't say a lot. There was all it takes is one or two incidents, but they were outside for the most part.
I mean, this is how bad it was. We sat down with the vice of Pacific Division, mm-hmm. and we're the new owners. We're excited. Hey, we want to work with you. We'll do what you need. He just basically looked at us and said, "I'm trying to shut you guys down. You need to change this right now." But we had no idea. We didn't do it. It wasn't us. But we were able to change it around. It took 3 some odd years mm-hmm. of struggling to pay rent. We were, the business itself.
We kept having to borrow money just to keep it open. Sure. You know.
It's so cool. Who did the painting? I mean, all of that outside painting. Did you inherit it that way, or did you guys?
No, that's a good friend of ours, Jonas Never, who you'll find his work throughout Los Angeles. He's an amazing local artist, mm-hmm. and he came in and we just told him the ideas and what we liked about it, and he showed us a rendering, and we got excited, like, sweet, all right, brother,
let's
bring it on. Yeah,
It really is great. I like that kind of art personally. I like street art. I like that kind of building art. And between how you've got Westchester and you've got an old Chevy or whatever it is, and you've got established, and then the Rams are coming back, and you've got that located up there as well. It's pretty cool.
He's famous enough where ESPN has paid him to do renderings. He did the Booyah thing, I think, on his own, but then they came up and shot it about 100 times and put it online. And,
nice.
And I think they commissioned him to do the Rams.
Yeah, well, that was actually on his, the Booyah, that was actually his own expression. It wasn't to get any attention, and he happened to just put it on his Instagram, and then it was a friend that was like, wow, and I think they started sharing it, and then it blew up for him.
Well, mm-hmm. Isn't Booyah also the sports announcer?
That's who it is.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. I mean, he just recently
There's a
passed.
Painting up on our roof
right. Yeah.
Right.
That you can't see very well from the parking lot, but people still come and try to climb on the roof, and, you know, I try to explain
good.
To them, no, it's not good.
You cannot do that. You cannot do that. Right. So now you're more than a bar. Now you're the Melody Bar and Grill, and you want to be known for not just a place where everybody knows your name and you have a beer, because now you actually do some fine dining. Tell me a little bit about that, because you mentioned that cooking was something that you enjoyed. So how were you? Are you the brains behind the menu and all of that?
Yeah, I've loved cooking since I was a kid, and that is just it's always been a passion of mine. And so I love creating dishes and different specials and really finding out what the area wanted in terms of to be able to come back and enjoy the food. At first, coming from Santa Monica and having Mackay, that was a whole different food scene than what was going on up here. And we at first introduced this new menu, and we kind of had to put the brakes on that and like listen to what everyone wanted. And like, okay, well, if even down to, let's say, your basic like wings, let's say, or bar food that some people say, we take it a step further and buy everything locally. We use a local butcher. Our breads come from a local bakery. Nothing's frozen ever. Everything's always hand cut.
That's really saying something. I mean, truly. I don't know that your customers know that, but you know that that's what your quality is.
Yeah, and that's why everyone who comes in, they love the food. I mean, down to, let's say, for example, the wings. They're never frozen. We season them. We bake them before they're fried so that there's an extra flavor on them.
Sure.
Or our hamburgers. It's not your run-of-the-mill Angus steak or Angus blend. Ours is an actual steak blend with New York short rib and sirloin. And it comes on a pretzel bun from Rock and Wagger Bakery.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah. No, everything is fantastic, and we go out of our way to make sure that it's fresh. Our turkey, it's not deli meat that you go and slice. We actually bake, roast every turkey breast, and then put it on our turkey clubs. It's just the little things that you just take that little extra effort, and it's just the quality of the food. It just takes that extra mile.
Well, I can hear the pride. I mean, it's clear that, you know, that's really important to you. Do you open at lunch? What are your hours typically? I mean, you don't serve breakfast, do you?
We do a limited brunch on the weekends. Mm-hmm. If you want a breakfast sandwich during the week, you can have it. We've tried opening early and for breakfast, but it never really quite caught on. We
Waffles.
we bought waffle machines, and you can build your own waffles with crazy toppings, besides fresh fruit toppings and different like whipped creams and different chocolates and sprinkles and M&Ms and bacon, and you just go on and on. And the people that came in loved it. It just was just too hard in terms of running the place and staffing the kitchen to make all this happen.
Sure.
To be a breakfast spot.
Certainly.
I still have a passion and a dream. Someday it'll catch on the weekends.
But well, typically you open it at noon. Is that?
At 11.
Or 11. All right.
Yeah.
I know. I was there not too long ago for a burger and fries sitting at the bar. And, you know, there's a lot of interesting people. I did not feel uncomfortable being there by myself, which I think says something also about the environment in there, that you don't have to feel like if you don't have a date or if you don't have a spouse or you don't have a friend that you're with, doesn't mean that you shouldn't go in there and enjoy yourself as well. And there were all kinds of people in there that were doing all kinds. There were travelers, and then there were locals as well.
Well, that was a milestone to get to that point. You know, like when we got there, that wasn't true.
Mm-hmm.
And what was remarkable, I think, what was the luckiest part of that whole process was learning that the music had more to do with it than anything. You know, that we were lucky enough to find it. If we didn't play certain music, or we concentrated on other things that were more generally, you know, enjoyed, that it took care of a lot of the
riffraff.
It made it a nicer place, you know, so that everybody, so the neighborhood could come back. So many people have said, oh, we used to come here with my dad or you know, years ago, and we're happy to come back and enjoy the place again.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Now it is like Cheers. It's such a neighborhood spot. It's all walks of life. It's all ages. It's interracial couples. It's gay couples. It's everyone. It's a hodgepodge, melting pot, and everyone just chills and vibes together and has a great time.
And you do have a happy hour, though, is that right?
Daily, 4 to 7 every day.
And do you have a special happy hour menu that you
offer?
We
do. Yeah, it's a discount on some of our food and some of our drinks. And then Friday, our happy hour, we have a DJ. And so, like at 6:30 at night, it feels like it's a midnight somewhere. Mm-hmm. I mean, the place is popping off. It's pretty cool.
And there's a whole sports bar kind of potential, I would call it. Still,
do you have a lot of people there last night?
Well, yeah.
Decent crowd.
Yeah,
but not packed wall to wall.
Friday it was. Friday, yeah. Everybody came. It seemed like we had a big Friday because of that. Or it helped kick off between happy hour and early evening. It's a great time for games to happen,
sure,
for us. And I'm excited about the Rams. I'm glad you're a sports fan, Marsha, because when the Rams come to town, we will be right down the road from them.
You're right.
They'll play in the Coliseum for a couple of years, and then they'll be right down
Manchester Manchester, where the racetrack was. Isn't that where they're doing it, by the Forum?
Yep, the Forum.
Right.
Yeah. I think the Forum stays, and they somewhere around, they have 60 acres, I guess, that the guy bought.
This
but the
so
Rams will be here,
everyone.
And they'll be here this coming year. We hope to run a bus, start open maybe a little early and have breakfast and do all that.
Oh,
for Rams
great.
Fan, put them on a bus and do like a tailgate
party.
Same
like they would do like for the Hollywood Bowl, and you're going to send them to
exactly.
The football
I just
game.
Did that trip, and it was a lot easier than driving and parking, you
oh,
know?
Gosh.
Yeah, and at the new stadium, there's no tailgating, so they can come to our bar, have get pregame on, and then we'll shuttle you down to the Coliseum.
Little breakfast.
Yeah.
Oh, you guys
to the
are
new
gonna,
stadium.
That is a brilliant idea. And there is ample parking, so it's
yes.
not like...
Especially on a Sunday, there's
absolutely.
Tons of parking.
Absolutely.
The B of A and the, even if we have to make a deal with them or whatever. But, we can put a lot of people on buses to go down there.
That's
you know?
So cool. Well, believe it or not, I told you this goes fast. So, and you know, I picked this music especially for you guys. So I don't know if you're
thanks.
Familiar.
Thanks. I mean, look at Bob's shirt. You know, he's got representing
Bob.
Marley today.
Yes, he is. But have you heard this song before?
Oh, yes.
You very have. Good. Remember, we're our child in the room.
Right.
So,
what?
Right.
No, I was in high school when this was out. this version anyway. I don't know how.
Yeah, it's probably a read.
Yeah, this is the original, I believe. Anyway, you're listening to Born to Talk. I'm Marsha. I'm here with Christian and with Bobby. Stay tuned, everybody. We'll be right back.
Choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
SoCal NOMA, the Southern California chapter of the National Organization of Minority Architects, is hosting its 7th annual 3-day summer camp on 3 successive Saturdays, July 9th, July 16th, and July 23rd. for ages 10 through 15, with a reception and award ceremony on July 30th at Southern California Institute of Architecture. Campers will enjoy a one-day field trip created to engage new ideas for famous and important local community projects. Day two of the camp will be hands-on exploration of the campers' innate qualities as it relates to building design experience. And day three will include learning how to use a three-dimensional computer software program to create the built environment. To learn more and to register, go to SoCalNOMA.org, that's SOCALNOMA.org, and click on the Camp NOMA page. Be sure to register today at SoCalNOMA.org. SoCalNOMA, proud sponsors of LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network.
What would your life be like if you needed blood transfusions every 2 or 3 weeks just to survive, and if you had to worry about all the iron from that blood making your heart and liver shut down? That's just what life is like for a person with thalassemia. If two people who each carry the trait for thalassemia have a child, there's a 25% chance with each pregnancy that the child will have thalassemia. For more information, visit the Cooley's Anemia Foundation at www.thalassemia.org. That's thalassemia. Or call 212-279-8090.
Did you know sickle cell disease is the most common genetic disorder in the world? In fact, millions of people are affected by sickle cell across the globe. Don't you think that a disorder of this magnitude deserves more attention? Get educated. Create awareness today. This ad was sponsored by Sickle Cell 101 Education Plus Awareness. Please visit SC101.org. That's SC101.org to learn more.
Sickle cell disease is projected to become a leading cause.
Welcome back, everybody. This is Zach Brown Band. Have you ever heard of them?
Yeah.
I love it. Jump right back. Just jump right in.
We have a country fan. Our bartender's a country fan, so most afternoons you'll hear Zach Brown.
Is that right?
DY.
Oh, I know who DY is.
Or Sinatra. I don't know where. He's eclectic.
He's confused right now. So we've talked about your history. We've talked about your menu. We've talked about your happy hour. Let's spend a little time talking about the entertainment that you guys provide for the community. So it's kind of a one-stop shop. You can go and have drinks. You can go have something to eat. And then, by and large, you could stay around and do other stuff. So what are some of the entertainment options?
Well, there's always some kind of entertainment, musical entertainment. It's been called – well, it's part of the reason we kept Melody in the title and kept the name. I've had experts in the field, Tony P., for instance, told me that, Bobby, you got to change the name of the place. And I go, well – you know, Tony, everybody knows where it is. It's got a reputation, but everybody knows where it is. Plus the music. I want to keep the music, and, mm-hmm. and we have. We have Happy Hour Entertainment Wednesday. A DJ from this building, Keith comes over.
Who's blind, gets accused of being.
Oh, I think I even know who that guy is.
There's a couple doors down from you guys.
Right, Power. Power Tech. Okay, Power Tech. So he's your DJ?
He DJs on Wednesday during happy hour.
That's cool.
And then we have happy hour entertainment Thursday and Friday well. And then just about every night there's something. There's either karaoke or a band or DJs. Every night we have some kind of musical entertainment.
Can people dance? Is there a space or not really?
People dance. I mean, yeah, they get
not
up.
Not if you're an insurance person, but other than that.
That's cute.
You know, sometimes you just hear that song and you got to get up.
You got to get up, absolutely.
Yeah, so Monday, Wednesdays, those are our karaoke nights. Tuesday, we have a DJ. And then Wednesday, during happy hour, we have Keith. And then Thursday, we have a David Boyles, who is kind of like he's a guitar player and plays phenomenal licks, and then repeats it and usually has a rhythm section.
Cool.
And it's
acoustic or electric?
It's a little both acoustic and electric. And then the weekends we usually have, like Thursday, Friday, Saturday night, usually is some kind of rock and roll cover band alternative to classic and some originals. And then Sunday night's a DJ.
Do you have trouble booking those? Or are people coming to you saying, I would really like
people
some exposure?
People want to play. And in the beginning, I handled the bands. And no offense, musicians, but some of you are high maintenance. So we've handed that off, and actually Bobby's daughter takes care of all bands and all the bookings for us. Yes.
Yeah, I'm lucky to have her working there, and my son as well. They both tend bar, and Vera takes care of books the bands.
Nice.
Yeah. I'm trying to retire, but I'm not even remotely close.
You know, there is something to be said for retiring, however. But
I like
to
think about it.
Well, there you go.
What's your plan? When are you retiring, Bob?
It's not a goal.
I wouldn't know what to do. But.
Yeah, exactly. It's open up another business, which I think we're going to talk about in a little bit. I think it's important for folks to know just how close we are to the airport. I have lived in this community my entire life. I lived practically underneath the runway when the old airport wasn't as enormous as it is today. And it doesn't matter how long I've lived here. When I'm standing in that parking lot in a Qantas or one of these big...
I love those big ones when they're flying over.
And you just can't even believe it, can you? They're
just
huge.
It never gets old, though. It never gets old.
It doesn't get old.
It's so cool.
It is cool.
Well, when you're standing in our parking lot, they look like they're just going to drop onto you.
Absolutely.
You can't believe they're going to clear these signs next door to us. And they come almost right overhead. One of our fantasies is to buy the building and to put a rooftop lounge up there and play airport bingo, where you lay back with an umbrella drink and a lounge chair, and you go, I've got Qantas coming down. And, I played this game in my family's car, auto bingo.
Uh-huh.
And when a Volkswagen comes down, you mark Volkswagen.
If you had it, and
we'll do it with airlines.
Exactly. It's so funny. Like the 747s, when those big bumps, they started coming in, and then it's unbelievable.
They're about a 9 iron away. I mean, they're seriously close. And once in a while, you don't see it often, is one of those big birds are coming in, they're coming in slow, and then for whatever reason, they have to gun it. And then they just full throttle it because they got called off the runway. And then it's just the whole building shakes.
Yeah.
It's pretty wild.
In the early days, I tried to sleep in the back. And at 6 o'clock, they start rolling in. And you cannot, say you go to bed at 3:30 or whatever, close the bar, and you take a little nap. You're up at 6:30 because you can't. It's just just physically knock you out of bed.
Exactly. It's what we're accustomed to, isn't it? People will say, do you hear that? It's like, we hear it. We just always hear it. I don't really think a lot about it.
It's a great place to make noise at night, though. Nobody can complain. The guy next door came down and complained one time because we had bands out in the parking lot. It was a little extreme for us, but he came over from the massage parlor. I didn't even know he owned it, but he comes over and he just had a beer and said, laughed it off. Once a couple planes came rolling in noise. And this is what we like about this.
Yeah, we're actually in proximity to LAX. We are the closest bar and grill to LAX outside of a hotel. So you don't want to – maybe you're staying at the hotels, but you don't want to pay those hotel prices or airport
or parking.
Prices. Yeah.
Or hotel parking.
Here's the deal. You know, when you're picking somebody up at the airport, you go to the bar, you sit there, you order whatever. And as soon as your people not land, not even get their bags, when they're on the curb with their bags,
exactly.
Then they call you because it takes about a minute and a half to go over and pick them up. And otherwise, you're just going to be harassed.
Oh, absolutely.
Now, here's the hot tip, though.
Okay.
So let's say you don't want to deal with driving into LAX. You come sit at our bar. Now, across the street, there's this it's called the parking spot. And they have free shuttles going around and around LAX. They're the polka dot ones.
Mm-hmm.
There's two locations, one Sepulveda, one Century. Make sure you get on the Sepulveda one. So they're going to get on the bus, you get on the shuttle, and the driver's going to ask you, self park or valet? You tell him self park, go back, mind your business. He's going to drop you off at the Sepulveda parking spot, make sure you tip them, and then just walk across the street and you're at our bar. Because a taxi cab will charge you $20 just to take you from the airport to our bar, which is less than a quarter, you know, it's not even a quarter mile. It's like right there.
Well, it's a walk because people have done it every time they've had a Homeland Security incident or, you know, mysterious package or whatever, where they've had all kinds of trouble. But when people have to leave the airport and they know they can't go anywhere, they can walk to the bar.
Yeah.
It's not safe crossing Sepulveda, but other than that, it's close.
So the landmark that we use for most people who live in Los Angeles, they know where LAX is because at some point in their lives, they travel or pick someone up. And with that being said, they know where the In-N-Out Burger is right next to them, and they've probably even been there. We are directly across the street, so it's easy to just drive by and not even see us.
I was glad you said that because I wasn't going to bring up In-N-Out. But, I mean, clearly In-N-Out is definitely a landmark. A lot of people will have their cameras, and that's a place for their shooting planes. Not shooting planes, but photographing them.
Be careful. You're going to get a call.
I think of that because I take pictures. But what I'm saying is that you'll get a double-double and fries, and you hope you can sit down. You're getting a whole lot more where you are.
Yeah, and we have a patio, so you can have your drink, your cocktail, whatever it is, your burger, whatever you're eating. You can watch the planes land. Yeah, and there's ample free parking. Free. That's not happening anywhere else in Los Angeles.
And I will say that the In-N-Out employees come over and have our burgers. So
what's that tell you exactly?
What does that tell you? That's pretty funny. You've been in the community a long time. I know because of my association with the YMCA that you guys have been philanthropic with the Y. In fact, I just saw you in an event a month or so ago when you were doing your pizza, which we'll talk about as well. What are some of the other things that you guys have done? I think you've done something to even help this radio station. Is that right?
Yes. We would send pies up for a bunch of shows that you guys would have and just feed everyone.
The veterans, right?
Yes. Yes.
That's nice. Farhan is running the board. Farhan is part of the veterans. Farhan is a veteran. And I know that he appreciates that as well. You did something with LMU. You've done something where you've just provided some drinks or some food or.
Drinks and food. I mean, there's a lot of different schools in the area that have fundraisers. Mm-hmm. We'll donate food. We'll donate gift certificates for raffles and whatnot. If they need, so people now they hit us up, but actually when we first took this place over and we wanted to become part of the community besides joining the Chamber of Commerce, what else could we do? We actually had a girl who worked in the office who would reach out to nonprofits and say, hey, you want to have a fundraiser? Have it at our place. And, just to be part of the community and just to help out, because that's one of our biggest things is to let everyone know we're here, we're part of this community because we love it.
Were you going to say something else, Bobby?
Oh, just I remember going to the fire department with our early days. We brought a bunch of lunches over to the fire department just without even calling them or saying anything. And pretty soon our waitresses were riding around the fire trucks and having a great time. And they've always been good to us, and we see them now and then. But there's a lot of in the Y. We do their casino night every year. They do a casino thing. We come over with a bar basically and set it up and contribute that toward their charity thing.
Yeah, and then anytime there's an LAX Coastal Chamber event, they'll hit us up, and no problem. We love those guys and helping out where we can and donate to them. And anything that has to do with Westchester or our surrounding local towns are definitely a part of that.
You know, it's funny because when I was working at the – no, I wasn't working. I had already retired. Chad was at the Y at that point. And we were doing our annual fundraising, and we ended up going to the Melody, and we had our meeting, and we ate, and then we were in your dining area. You kind of took over the whole place. And, I mean, that was very generous of you to open that up to us and kind of keep it specifically designed for YMCA volunteers. I remember that was a really great event.
Well, that reminds we've always had things kind of on hold or in planning or whatever to like maybe have early morning meetings for the bankers mm-hmm. or, you know, like they go somewhere, have some breakfast or whatever. We have the facility for it. We could we don't open that early ordinarily, but we could, mm-hmm. you know, open up the lounge. They could have a PowerPoint presentation on the big TV and serve coffee and breakfast or donuts or whatever. There are a lot of potential still in that in the place that we haven't really fully accessed. I know we've done some stuff with the Elks Club. It was always fun. They're great mm-hmm. people.
Yeah.
On the other side of Westchester.
Yeah, and we've worked with LMU as well.
Yeah, right. Lots of stuff at LMU, especially when Jess was with us. She got hired beyond our means to.
We had an LMU alumni working with us for a while.
Nice. Well, and besides that, so you've got the bar going, you got the Melody Bar going, but that isn't all. You opened up another business just down the street from the bar.
Four doors down from the bar. Yes, it's a pizzeria. Kept the name Melody, so Melody Pizza. And yes, we deliver late night till 12 p.m. Sunday through Thursday, 2 a.m. Friday and Saturday. For all those people that are up, probably might have a little bit of a buzz that want something to eat, or those weary travelers. We deliver a ton to all the local hotels right next to LAX.
That's nice.
And we've become quite a cool little Westchester pizzeria. This, you know, we get a lot of repeat business, a lot of customers.
And that isn't enough. So you got the bar, you got the pizzeria, and then what did you do? You decided, I need another business
so
on top of that.
So this circles back to our mutual friend who pretty much introduced us. He'll come up in the story. Uh-huh. So before opening up Mackay, I was a bartender at the Baja Cantina for about 6 years. And then I moonlit at James Beach
and was
bartending there with a guy named John Binder, who's my partner now. And he's still bartending there. But so back then, at the end of the shift, we were talking, doing our checkout, sipping on our Sierras, because that's all there really was back there. There wasn't a big craft beer boom. Talking about how cool Venice is and how much we love Venice and how it needed its own brewery. And in that same conversation, I told him a story about our mutual friend, Hap, who went to a party in the Venice canals, and he got so drunk, like hammered, he woke up in the canals covered in ducks. And it was actually covered in ducks and then a goose on his chest. And then when he woke up, the goose honked, and then he said, whoa, and then everything, they all flew off of him. And then the Venice Duck Brewery, the vision was born. And then fast forward through life and some kids, and then they started seeing craft beer popping up. I got on the phone with my buddy Binder, like, dude, are you in? I'm doing this. Let me know. And then so we just started the whole friends and family, developing, like raising some capital, developing recipes, finally got our beer onto market, self-distributed out of the back of a pickup truck.
Oh, gosh.
And thrown our backs out. Then got picked up by a big distributor. And now you can find us mostly on the west side, but throughout Los Angeles and actually from San Diego to California.
Really?
Yeah, you can find us through like LAX and all the bars and in
Venice.
That's cool. Yeah.
We're going to take our last break. And when we come back, I don't think you're the only one that started a second business, because I believe Bobby wanted to have his second business too.
He gave up on that retiring thought.
Exactly. That's never going to happen. We're going to come back and talk about that,
okay.
Bobby. So the name of this song, I just love this song, is called I Hardly Ever Sing Beer Songs Anymore by Johnny Cash.
Love it.
Can you believe it? I mean, really. You're going to have to Google this and actually play the whole song.
Check this song out.
I love this bar. Exactly.
It's a great song.
It is a good song. I'm sorry I didn't think of it. You should have sent me that.
I should have.
Yes, you should have.
I just thought of it.
Well, it's a little late, don't you think?
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
We had a bartender that loved that song.
That's great.
I had to leave him unemployed.
Okay. We're going to take a break. We'll talk about it off camera. Stay tuned, everybody. We'll be right back. Love has all gone wrong. I don't lose no sleep at night, 'cause things with you are going right. And I hardly ever sing beer drinking songs. Mm-hmm.
call your name out in my sleep. You never make me worry, and you never make me weep. I never wonder if you're true.
I
spend the night curled up with you.
So I learned how to be a friend.
And I never call your name out in my sleep.
Hey, shout out to What's the Count? I'm Ferran Dozier.
And I'm your boy, Cali Sportsman, inviting you to join us
every Saturday at 2 p.m. Pacific on the Sports Lounge Live.
Explore the world of sports, from amateur to the pros, the community on a global level, relevant sports news, and guess what? We even have live studio guests.
So don't forget to tune into the Sports Lounge Live every Saturday, 2 p.m. Pacific, exclusively on LATalkLive.com and the America Talk Live Broadcast Network.
Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live.
And we are more than just talk. Hey, shout us out, What's the Count? I'm your host, I am WDC. Tune in to WDC Radio on LA Talk Live every Saturday at 4 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 7 p.m. Eastern Time for sickle cell trait awareness, lupus, bullying, mental health, and all different aspects of life. So tune in to WDC Radio right here on LA Talk Live. Also, you can listen to us on iTunes, Live 365, YouTube, and Ustream. And don't forget Apple TV and Roku right here on LA Talk Live, where we're more than just talk. Shout us out. What's the Count?
Welcome. This is Greg inviting you to tune in Saturday, 6 p.m. to the Mystic Ballroom. All vinyl most of the time, and we'll cover psychedelic, soul, garage, and much, much more. Myself and the Young Mogul, we're bringing you this every Saturday at 6 p.m. exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio, R&B, Live 365 Radio, Flag, TuneIn Radio, AHA Radio, TV Radio, and Apple TV Radio. Or you can watch, listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for yours and mine, listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
She was so nice. Lord, she was lovey-dovey. So I go in my room, pack up my things, and I go. I slip on out the back door. Down the streets I go.
Welcome back, everybody. One bourbon, one scotch, one beer. Is that all at one time?
Pretty much.
George Thorogood.
I think so.
I mean, it's a classic.
I've done that.
You know, he does 8 minutes worth of that whole story.
Well, you kind of have to once it's sung.
Exactly.
Most
definitely. Before we come back to you guys, I do want to let everybody know about my show next week, because every week I have a new guest with a new angle and a new passion. And Rock Bordenoves is going to be here next week. And he not only is a musician, he's a saxophone player, but he's a voiceover artist. So he does a lot of voiceovers. And also he does disc golfing. And I don't think most people even know what disc golfing is. Have you ever heard
of it? Frisbee golf.
It's like frisbee golf. Uh-huh. And
I've seen soccer golf at a golf
There's all kinds like that. Well, so Rock does that as well. So we're going to be talking with him next week, and I really look forward to you meeting him. But I did want to get back to you, Bobby, because we talked about Christian's new businesses. You're also opening another business as well.
Well, right. I have a pizza place trying to open. It's been that way. I'm going through the same problems that Christian did in opening. Just takes forever to get mm-hmm. through the city and all the requirements, and then they change things. And in fact, my whole takeoff of this is we've actually made some progress. It's in Long Beach. It's on 7th in Nebraska.
Right.
It'll be open any day now. Don't
any
know when.
Any day now.
But we've actually improved the city's handling of new businesses. I mean, we complain that, you know, this people should take your hand and show you how to get it done. It shouldn't be in opposition to you. Sure, make it clean, make it healthy, make it safe.
Right.
But the city should be
benefits.
Trying to increase
exactly.
business and their tax base and jobs. And they do the opposite. I mean, that's the effect.
The
anyway,
hoops.
They make you an enemy and not a potential friend. They should really walk you through it. Here's a list of things you need to do, things that you're going to maybe fall short on. What I see here is this. They're going to make several visits anyway.
Sure.
The first one should be, you know, welcome to Long Beach. You know, I'm glad you're starting this business, but it's totally the opposite. Anyway.
Well, you know, it's interesting because one of the questions I was going to ask you, and it sort of falls into what you were just talking about, is that what are some of the challenges? I know what I would think some of the challenges is of running the business that you run together. Is it staffing?
Yeah, it's staffing. Labor is definitely one of the biggest challenges, from hiring the right staff, trusting the right staff, and then labor costs. There's a lot. It's a big puzzle piece that you have to, a lot of moving parts that you have to put together. Besides just the staff, and like Bob was saying, dealing with the city. Here we are. We're employing all these people. We're giving back to the community. But they don't make it easy for you to want to run a small business.
Health department,
sure,
and building and safety just seem like your enemies. They oppose everything you do. We built a beautiful patio in response to the Westchester bid, who improved the Sepulveda Boulevard and begged everybody to put awnings out and patios and access on Sepulveda to their business. We did all that, and all we got was flack from the building of safety. We had the only patio in existence that we had to take in at night.
He compared us to a patio on Sunset Boulevard because some pedestrian or someone on the sidewalk got into it with a business and they had some kind of drawn out argument. I don't know if you've been on Sepulveda lately in front of our place. You might get a handful maybe of people walking by.
Lots of cars.
But yeah, lots
of
cars.
Lots of cars.
And so we wanted to just extend our to have a patio go out 2 feet, and there was plenty of which would have still given plenty of room for a handicap over 6 feet, and it was like fighting tooth and nail just to try to make our patio happen.
Anyway, everybody's going to face that, and everybody's one of the biggest challenges I find in the business in general is the realization, and we've passed the buck on this and sabotage each other to do it. Is you have to fire people, you know, and we take pleasure in it. It's very hard, and it's something when you go into business, you're going to have to realize that you're going to have to be that guy sometimes.
That's the downside, but there's got to be a plus side. Otherwise,
there's
why
lots
would you
of
do
plus
it?
Sides.
Let's give me a plus.
The plus, I would say, if you do it right and you have an amazing staff, I'd like to give a shout out to our staff. They do an amazing job. Our day bartender, DY, thank you so much for your dedication and hard work. The regulars that you do meet, everyone that comes in and their adjective for Melody. Yes. So what do you think about Melody? I love Melody. That's one thing that everyone says. I love Melody. Or for me, the satisfaction, like complimenting the food. Oh, we love the food. We love the food. Someone coined our food as gastro dive because, you know, the gastro pubs are coming up. So
exactly.
People call our food like restaurant food in a dive bar, basically. I mean, there's a lot of pluses.
Yeah, it's pride, you know, in the place. One of our bartenders, I actually found him in the ice machine cleaning it out. He was all the way in it, scrubbing it down and everything. He used to play "I Love This Bar" every day, you know, and that's how people react to it. They either don't come or they love it, you know. And we have fortunately a growing and really good business in the sense of what we talked about earlier is anybody can walk in there by themselves or with a bunch of people, and we can take care of them, and they'll be
made to feel welcome.
They absolutely. Yeah. It's the most accessible. Accessibility is one of the top priorities, I think, in any business.
You bet.
You got to make people feel at home when they come in, and they want to come in.
Right.
Everybody understands what it is, and it's a neighborhood bar.
How do you balance? Because you have three kids, you have adult children, but how do you balance what you do?
That's a good question. It's a great question, actually. Well, at some point, you realize that you have to let go and trust your staff, and you know that you're never quite able to let go completely because if there's an emergency or something's going on with work, you do have to respond. Questions coming in, this broke, there's a leak there. You know, you're never quite just, you can't just go home and say, I'm done for the day if stuff comes up.
Sure.
But there is, that's where, you know, we find the balance. don't want to speak for Bobby, but just it's having a great staff is that you can trust.
Yeah, you have to, that's why you have to fire people. You have to find the right people and keep them, and we've been really fortunate.
Well, that's terrific. This hour went fast, didn't it?
It did.
Because I can feel it, and I'm sure people that are listening and watching can appreciate what you've put into your business, and encouraging people. You're our community place to stop.
I want to thank Marsha here. What an amazing host. She put so much work together into making sure that we didn't suck and kept us organized.
Yeah, you didn't really suck.
It was super fun, and I appreciate
it.
Thank
you. Well,
you
know what? And I think I know where to go hang out on a Wednesday night, right?
Yes.
Karaoke.
And I do some Johnny Cash, so.
Uh-oh.
And I wonder who I will do. Stevie Nicks. All right, so you'll have to come back and listen for that. Thanks, everybody. Have a beautiful day. I'll see you next week on Born to Talk, where these conversations plus these connections equal the community that we love. Thanks so much for listening, and we'll see you next week. And thanks to everybody that was here. Tia the Terrific's in the studio.
Thank you.
And Jay, my intern. Thanks, Jay. Everybody have a great week. Your love is done. Even if that doesn't ring true, you've been all over, and it's been all over you. It's a beautiful day to let it get away. It's a beautiful day.
Thank you for tuning into LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network, original reality radio, and crafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. Stay tuned.